بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Dear colleagues, tonight we have exceptional speakers and moderator. The speakers, all of us, we know our leader in the Arab world, the professor of anesthesia, Professor Mohamed Abdulatif. All of us, we know him. He is a pioneer in the field of muscle relaxants. And today he will talk about the anesthesia and the future during COVID. And this is a very important subject. And we hope by the end of this year, inshallah, COVID will vanish and we will not speak about the COVID and anesthesia later on. So I hope this lecture will be the last lecture in the field of the COVID. The second speaker is Professor Ahmed Taha. He is a professor of anesthesia in Ain Shams, and he is now working in Abu Dhabi. And he is well known in his experience since about 15 years or 20 years in the field of regional anesthesia. Also, my great honor to speak about my professor, the moderator, Professor Khalda Radwan, who is the former chairman of the anesthesia department in Tudor Belharz Institute in Egypt. And she is well known in the field of the transplant, liver transplant. And I leave the floor for her to introduce our eminent speaker. Thank you so much. And please, Dr. Khalda, floor is yours. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Dr. Essam. Thank you very much. Actually, it's a great pleasure to participate in such a big event and introduce my dear professor, Dr. Mohamed Abdulatif. He is my teacher from the beginning, and he is our pioneer in either anesthetic practice or in research. He will give us a lecture. He is a professor in anesthesiology faculty of medicine at Cairo University. He is an associate editor in British Journal of Anaesthesia. He is our guide, he is our godfather in anesthesia. He will talk about interesting subject and a very important subject, and we hope will be finished, inshallah, the impact of COVID-19, current and the future anesthetic anesthesia practice, and how we deal with this. We hope get benefit, of course, of Dr. Abdulatif and guide us to deal with such important problem, inshallah. Please, Dr. Abdulatif. Share your screen.
Thank you very much, Dr. Tabs, for having me introduced. Thank you so much for your introduction. Thanks also for my dear colleague, Dr. Khalda, for the great introduction. Let me say something about the comment of Dr. Essam. This is the last lecture. Actually, to me, I think this is the first formal lecture about the impact of COVID-19 on current and future anesthesia practice. I think even on the international level, I have not encountered a lecture about anesthesia and COVID-19. There is a lot of publication, but a lecture, I think this is the first. And as we'll see later, I think we have more time to stay with COVID-19. My title is about the impact of COVID-19 on current and future anesthesia practice. As you all know, it is a branch of COVID. It is a little bit complicated COVID. That's why to handle this topic, we need to be focused and we need to be systematic. Intensive care issues related to COVID-19 and personal protective equipment are outside the scope of this lecture. The objective during the anesthetic management of suspected or proved COVID-19 patients are first to prevent cross infection from the patient to the healthcare providers and vice versa, and of course to prevent, correct, and hopefully improve organ function, mainly or primarily lung functions and other organ functions, kidney, cardiovascular, and coagulation. Current and future. Let us start by the impact of anesthesia on current practice. Again, I said we have to be systematic. So anesthetic management starts by preoperative assessment, the choice of the appropriate anesthetic technique for the appropriate patient, for the appropriate surgical procedure, for the appropriate surgeon. Then finally, you do appropriate conduct for the chosen anesthesia technique. We start by preoperative assessment, history, examination, and investigation. And these are currently commonly done bedside, either in the patient room or in the pre-anesthesia assessment clinic. It is bedside. We need a change. Definitely, with the horrible coronavirus pandemic, we need a change. We need to make patient-doctor distancing as much as we can and as much as possible. We need to do, again, if possible, patient-doctor different locations. This could be achieved by telemedicine, which is very well known ahead of the pandemic of COVID-19, but it is now time to think carefully to implement this whenever possible, whenever available. This article was published in the Best Practice Clinical Reception Clinical Anesthesia in June 2020 about the use of telemedicine in preoperative assessment recommendation for clinical care. And they said it has to be from bedside, it has to be the website. Okay, it is a classical trial. How can we implement telemedicine with history, examination, investigation? Apparently, telemedicine for history is very easy. You can take remotely full history from the patient through the social media, through the phone communication or the laptop communication. You can even see some signs. You can see whether he's cyanosed, he is distant, and other signs remotely through the social media. So history by telemedicine appears to be an easy task. Investigation also is a very easy task. The patient can send his radiology, his x-ray, I mean his lab investigation, even ECG, echo report. This could be easily exchanged by using telemedicine. And there is really a clinical application to this. One big institute in the States, which is the University of California, Los Angeles, recently published their experience with the use of telemedicine in preoperative assessment. In this article published December 2020 in Anesthesia and Analgesia, they reported that they compared 420 patients preoperative assessment using telemedicine to 1,780 patients using in-person interview. And they compared patient satisfaction. Patients were highly satisfied with remote preoperative assessment or telemedicine. We have reduced the cost of the hospital and the transportation of the patient from his home to the hospital to do the preoperative visit. And surprisingly, despite the fact they did not meet the patient in person, cancellation rate was comparable between in-person and telemedicine preoperative assessment. Mind you, there is a precaution. This telemedicine or remote assessment or remote exchange of patient information should be confidential, should be done through a secured server from the hospital, not through the personal telephone communication. This is very important. So we said history, investigation, telemedicine, very easy. What about remote examination? A bit difficult, but still, there are some examples where you can do some part of the preoperative examination remotely. For example, auscultation, we'll see soon that it could be done remotely. I mean, auscultation of the chest and or the breath sounds and the heart sounds. We can show you also how people are thinking to avoid the very high risk examination of the airway, which is in direct contact with the upper airway and which can transmit a huge load of COVID-19. Let us start by how can we remotely do auscultation. Is this possible? Actually, yes. By using the amazing Bluetooth stethoscope. By using this stethoscope, the patient could be in one room, the physician in another room, will instruct the patient to put the stethoscope on specified location. He can assess the heart sound and he can assess the chest sound or the breath sounds remotely. What about airway examination? The most serious, in my view, malabati in preoperative assessment. People are thinking around how to do an alternative despite the or to avoid the direct contact face to face with the patient breathing and opening his mouth fully and high risk of COVID-19 transmission. Transparent face mask, you can do COVID-19 without or with minimal aerosolization. One chair colleague from Morocco published recently his experience about how to avoid face-to-face examination of malambati. Very simple, he asked the patient to look in the mirror with his phone illumination, and he is seeing the malambati in the mirror and he is not facing directly the patient. He is trying to minimize transmission of virus load. And as a joke, you can easily do a selfie malambati. You know, selfie is going and very hard to utilize. You can do selfie malambati and send it to your doctor. So we finished preoperative assessment. And there is a big question now before proceeding to admitting the patient. Do we need to screen all elective surgery patients for COVID-19 or screen selective patients? This is debatable issue. Some hospitals are doing routine PCR and routine CT scan for all elective surgeries. However, this is a bit expensive and might not be applicable for all clinical scenarios. The recent recommendation from Australia, which was published this month, December 2020, they were more clinical. They said, you need to do PCR for the following categories. A patient with confirmed history of contact with a confirmed patient with COVID-19. Patient with symptoms highly suggestive of COVID-19. High risk profession, unfortunately, like doctors and nursing going themselves for operation. And for patients elderly, more than 70 years, having new onset respiratory symptoms, these patients should do PCR as well as a CT scan. Timing of elective surgery. When to proceed with elective surgery in a patient with a history of COVID-19 infection. Why we need to consider this timing? Actually, because this international court study published in Lancet this year indicated that 1,200 patients from 24 countries, they looked for 30 days mortality. I mean, these patients having a history of COVID-19, they looked for 30 days mortality and the outcome was alarming. 24% of patients with history of COVID-19 died postoperatively. Pulmonary complication 51% of these patients develop post-operative pulmonary complication. This pulmonary complication contributed to 80% of the mortalities. That's why you need to think about the interval between recovery from COVID-19 and timing of elective surgery. The American Society of Anesthesiologists and the Patient Safety Foundation issued a statement recently in December 8 about the proposed timing for elective surgery after recovery from COVID-19. If the patient is asymptomatic, 4 weeks, symptomatic with cough, dyspnea, but did not require hospitalization, 6 weeks. Symptomatic patient who is diabetic, I mean comorbidities, diabetes, immunocompromised, or hospitalized, 8 weeks. Patients admitted to ICU for COVID-19, you have to wait at least 12 weeks before going to elective surgery. Okay, we finished, we have done PCR, CT scan, according to the policy of your hospital, and it's time now to go for OR. Of course, you need to choose your anesthetic plan at this stage or even earlier before taking the patient to the operating room. The choices are two choices. Either you go for regional anesthesia or general anesthesia. This publication came recently in the BGA and they said, actually with COVID-19, regional anesthesia should be actually not in COVID-19, for all clinical scenarios, if it is possible, regional anesthesia should always be our choice if appropriate for surgery or appropriate for the patient. And as you can see, a lot of surgical interventions, this only example, could be done solely with regional anesthesia combined with minimal or a little bit deep sedation. For example, awake craniotomy, neurosurgeon, you can do it with local infiltration anesthesia and appropriate sedation. Thyroid surgery, you can do it with cervical plexus, lock superficial and deep. Upper and lower limb surgery, and lower limb surgery will be handled adequately by Ahmad Taha. It could be easily done with sole analgesia, regional anesthesia. Breast cancer surgery. Cancer surgery cannot be postponed, and this is an issue with in a patient with COVID-19. You cannot delay. You can do it with regional anesthesia. Shoulder surgery, especially arthroscopy, could be done with regional anesthesia. Abdominal surgery. Here, I stress open abdominal surgery, not laparoscopy. Could be done, of course, with neuroaxial anesthesia, like combined spinal epidural. Breast surgery, paravertebral block, big one and big two, and the recently introduced erector spinal block. Shoulder surgery is commonly done, or shoulder analgesia, commonly done with interscalene brachial plexus block. But in patients with COVID-19, you need to be cautious and try to avoid this block. Why? As you know, almost 80% of patients receiving conventional interscalene block will develop hemidiaphragmatic paralysis due to spread of the local anesthetic to the phrenic nerve innervation C3, C4, and C5. The alternative is to go for phrenic nerve sparing blocks like infraclavicular block and suprascapular nerve block. The European Society of Regional Anesthesia and the American Society of Regional Anesthesia issued guidelines for the management of regional anesthesia in patients with COVID-19. And these are summarized in the following graphs. First, you need to do planning and preparation. You need to check the COVID-19 status of your patient. If you are going for consent, verbal consent is okay to minimize contact with the patient. If you are going to give oxygen supplementation with sedation, they suggest or they recommend you put your nasal cannula or face mask covered by surgical mask to avoid or to minimize aerosolization. Equipment, pack your needles, drugs, or sterilization equipment in one sealed bag. Minimize the number of personnel in the room. Assign one single person in case you need additional equipment or additional medication to get it from outside the OR. And cover the machine. Normally you cover, sometimes you cover the probe. Cover the ultrasound machine and the probe with plastic cover. What about referral? As I said earlier, they recommend consider nerve blocks that does not affect the respiratory drive. I mean phrenic nerve sparing blocks. Regarding adjuvants, if you go for opioid adjuvants, you need to weigh the or to balance the extension of block against the possible respiratory depression of opioids. Regarding continuous catheters, some people are recommending this for home analgesia and others are against to minimize the contact with the patient. What about neuroaxial anesthesia? The bold statement is that neuroaxial anesthesia is not contraindicated in COVID-19 patients, even if they are feverish. Mind you, in patients with fever suspected for meningitis, we do lumbar or diagnostic lumbar puncture. So COVID-19 is not contraindication for neuroaxial block. However, experienced person should do it and try to minimize sedation to reduce respiratory compromise. If it comes to epidural blood dash due to dural tap, you have to be very careful and you have to think twice before inserting a blood contaminated with virus in or near the neuroaxis. The special consideration, as you all know, COVID-19 is associated with hypercoagulable state and most of the patients are on anticoagulant. Occasionally, they have immune-induced thrombocytopenia. And you need to check, of course, your coagulation profile. And actually, we are doing this for all patients, COVID or non-COVID. You need to be cautious with sedation. You need to monitor end-tidal CO2 if you provide sedation. You need to provide lowest possible flow of supplemental oxygen to minimize aerosolization. If you have a patient already with excessive cough, dyspnea, low saturation, this is not a candidate for regional anesthesia and you go for general endotracheal anesthesia. Okay, we finished the regional anesthesia. Suppose the patient is going for laparoscopic surgery or he is not a candidate for regional anesthesia and we have to give regional anesthesia. So I mean general anesthesia. Again, we'll go systematic. General anesthesia, we induce, we maintain, and we recover the patient from general anesthesia. Let us start, or as you know, the most serious respect to COVID-19 is induction and recovery because intubation and extubation are the most aerosol generating procedures during our anesthetic management. This is the guidelines for airway management in COVID-19 patients published in Anesthesia Analgesia, September 2020. They recommended for suspected or proved COVID-19 patient, intubation should be done using rapid sequence technique using video laryngoscopy. This will lead to more success, more distancing between you and the patient airway, and will avoid positive pressure ventilation and aerosolization. Of course, rapid sequence induction requires pre-oxygenation. This should be 5 minutes at least with two hands to minimize aerosolization and with the lowest possible oxygen flow. Filtration before intubation. It is recommended, and this is according to my dear colleague Ahmed Abdulafar, to put the viral and bacterial, or to mount the viral and bacterial filter on the endotracheal tube before intubation. With the COVID-19, everybody is trying to minimize aerosol and infection. They developed what's known as aerosol intubation boxes or aerosol intubation tents And this is one example. This is a tent supported by vacuum negative pressure to minimize the spread of virus to the operator during incubation. However, a recent review article in the British Journal of Anaesthesia, December 2020, concluded that the use of such type of equipment increases difficulty, increases the time of incubation with more incidence of hypoxemia, and the benefit out of this is questionable according to this review. Suppose you have a bit difficult incubation. Try to avoid the repeated attempt at incubation to minimize aerosolization. You can go for second generation supraglottic airways, for seal or IGL, for example. These are associated with a better seal and less aerosol. Try to make it spontaneous as much as you can with LMA, because it is not that fit like endotracheal tube. Positive pressure with LMA is non-COVID-19 is okay, but if you use positive pressure ventilation with laryngeal mask in a COVID-19, you have more aerosolization. What about fiber optic intubation? Usually, despite topicalization, sedation, it is commonly associated with agitation, coughing, and increased aerosolization. Try to avoid if possible, but if you need to do it cautiously. So we finished with onset and intubation. It is time now for the surgeon to come. Actually, the surgeon will ask you, can I come in after intubation? The first recommendation was to wait until you make a lockdown interval. And this interval depends on the air circulation and removal of air or refreshment of air in the OR. And in anesthesia analgesia, this table was published and it depends. Sometimes you have your OR 12 exchange per hour, up to 50 air exchange per hour. And the lockdown interval to clear coronavirus 99.9%, it ranges from 8 to 35 minutes. As you can see here, this is not practical. You intubate, keep your doctor waiting 35 minutes, and you repeat this after extubation. This is not practical. Fortunately, this correspondence or letter to the editor will come after 2 months in February 2021 in anesthesia, opening operating theater doors after aerosol generating procedure is not a high risk action. The hypothesis they hypothesized that they said, okay, it is closed, but there's always a leak from OR. It is not totally closed. And they said, suppose you have a COVID-19 room here, there is a leak with air contaminated with COVID-19, but there is also a leak from other rooms to the corridor. This will dilute the load of COVID-19 virus and will minimize the risk of air contamination in other OR. And actually, you don't need really to wait that much after endotracheal intubation to allow your surgeon to start surgery. Okay, surgeon in now, and we are in a phase of maintenance. And in this section of anesthesia, I'll talk briefly about circuit and machine protection from the virus, and the choice of inhalation versus total intravenous anesthesia, management of ventilation intraoperatively, and fluid therapy. How to protect the circuit? Actually, they recommend 3 filters. One before the eyepiece, definitely one on the expiratory limb. And they said, why not to put one on the expiratory limb? Why? The expiratory limb have a fresh gas flow. They said, okay, some people will be confused between expiratory and inspiratory limb. Let us put 2. This will add much to the cost and will make it more protected. So 3 filters are recommended. Y-piece, expiratory, and inspiratory limb. Inhalation versus total intravenous. They recommend total intravenous due to the following potential advantages. You can have long extension tubing away from the patient connected to the infusion pump, Debrivan, or remifentanil, etc. It has no airway irritation, minimal effect on the immune system, of course, reduced postoperative nausea and vomiting very well about fever and rapid recovery. What are the types of fever? Fever could be done without any airway manipulation at all. It's a peripheral surgery, fever, airway is okay, no much depression. You cannot manipulate airway. It could be also done without endotracheal intubation. And this has two subcategories, nasal airway, oral airway, or supraglottic device. Or lastly, you can do TIVA with endotracheal intubation. The least generating procedure, aerosol generating procedure, if possible, if you do TIVA without airway instrumentation. And the worst, if you do TIVA with supraglottic airway. What about management of ventilation? Basically, COVID-19 looks like pathologically like ARDS. So according to this review, which will be published February 2021 in the current opinion of critical care, they recommended that use lung protective ventilation strategy because of the similar pathology. Low tidal volume, plateau pressure less than 30, and PEEP, this is the protective lung ventilation strategy. What about fluid therapy? We have two options. A patient with a viral pneumonia similar to ARDS, minimize fluid load, or the patient developed secondary infection, bacteria infection, and this is not uncommon, it occurs. In this case, your fluid therapy will be according to the surviving sepsis campaign, which issued a revised version targeting the COVID-19 patient. And this is open access. You can access it and see there is minimal difference between the regular sepsis and the COVID-19 regarding fluid therapy and vasoactive medication. So we finished the maintenance, and now we are in the recovery phase of anesthetic management. Patient should be fully recovered. You need to maintain or improve lung function. You need to reduce aerosol as we have done during intubation. Your target, if you have given your patient neuromuscular blocker, zero post-operative residual coloration to maximize pulmonary function. Nystagmine or sugammadex. Logically, sugammadex is much more preferred if available. And this very important publication, this stronger study published June 22 in Anaesthesiology, compared sugammadex versus nystagmine antagonism of residual ropuronium blockade, and they compared post-operative pulmonary complications. And the conclusion, out of 45,000 records, it is a retrospective study, the use of sugammadex was associated with 30 to 50% reduction in post-operative pulmonary complications compared to the use of nystagmine. Okay, your patient adequately recovered from neuromuscular or residual neuromuscular blockade. How to manage extubation? Try as much as you can to reduce cough. Do appropriate suction before awakening your patient and before giving your antagonist. Give a dose of lidocaine, 1 to 1.5 milligram per kilogram. Low dose of dexmedetomidine, or simply, you can keep your sevoflurane at 1% until you extubate. Ensure that your patient is adequately ventilated to avoid positive pressure ventilation due to spasm or due to hypoventilation. It's recommended to clamp your endotracheal tube to avoid any gush of virus due to coughing during intubation. It is recommended to extubate under the surgical face mask. Keep your patient after extubation in OR. These patients, especially with known COVID-19, are not candidate for vacuum or recovery room. Keep them in OR until they are fully recovered, then discharge them to the designated isolation room, and in this place you start post-operative pain control. Regional anesthesia should be your first choice. multimodal analgesia, try to use an opioid sparing approach to minimize respiratory depression. There was a controversy with the use of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory in COVID-19, especially ibuprofen, and actually they said it make the prognosis worse. However, several publications came and they said there is no clear evidence that the use of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs can worsen the outcome of COVID-19 disease. We finished the management of general anesthesia. We finished the modification of regional anesthesia. We finished the current impact or the impact of COVID-19 on current anesthesia. But it's time now to look for the future. The following slides will look like science fiction, but you need to be reminded that science fiction always comes to reality. Man is walking on the moon, maybe 50 years now walking in the moon. Nobody can imagine this, but it is the reality. The future is robotization. Chinese robot doctor passed medical exam already. We have two types of robot in relation to anesthesia, or robot in relation to anesthesia, pharmacological robot and mechanical robot. Pharmacological robot are very well known long time ago. For example, diabetes, there is a closed loop control of blood sugar. Sensor, which measures blood sugar, interface or processor will send a signal to the insulin pump. It will push certain amount of insulin to maintain the target blood sugar. This is not new. It is there for several years or decades. What about application of this to anesthesia? It has been done already, several publications. You can make a closed loop control for the depths of anesthesia using bispectral index, a microprocessor will take the signal to maintain bispectral index at 40 to 60, the appropriate depth of anesthesia. And if it is lighter, it will push or will give a signal to the syringe pump, propofol and remifentanil to push more. If it is deep, it will reduce the infusion rate automatically. This is a closed loop control of anesthesia. This publication came to anesthesiology or appeared in anesthesiology February 2020, and the whole work was done well ahead before COVID-19. Anesthetic management using multiple closed loop systems. Closed loop hypnosis, closed loop ventilation, closed loop fluid therapy. At the end, bispectral index, microprocessor to the syringe pump to adjust the depth of anesthesia. What about ventilation? Target CO2, signal from inside the CO2 processor to the ventilation, increase, reduce ventilation to reach the target inside the CO2. Fluids, again, non-invasive cardiac output, stroke volume, processor, increase, decrease fluid therapy to maintain a target stroke volume. This article was accompanied by an editorial by Thomas Hammerling from Canada. Thomas Hammerling is a leader in robotic-related anesthetic techniques. He said in his editorial, robot will perform anesthesia in the near future. Okay, you said that fluids, hypnosis, and ventilation could be managed by closed loop. But what about airway management? What about the role of robot in airway management? You know, we robot already there in our clinical practice. I'm sure I saw Manaa, some centers in Egypt, and definitely with Saad, Dr. Saad, they have already the Da Vinci system or the robotic laparoscopic surgeon. As you can see here, the surgeon is away. He may be even in a different country. And there is a lot of arms for the robot, which you can cut, stitch, dissect, and do all the job remotely. So this is not new again for surgery. Probably it is a little bit new for anesthesiologists. And we don't, as anesthesiologists, we don't need all these arms. We need only one robotic arm. We need a joystick or an application on your mobile phone to manipulate this robotic arm. Look at this publication. Again, Thomas Hemmerling. In June 2012, 8 years back, he reported the first robotic tracheal intubation using the robot or Kimberly intubation system. Mind you, he has done this with robot, with video laryngoscope, using manipulation of the joystick. In the near future, the robot will do the whole job without joystick. What about regional anesthesia, Ahmed Taha? What about the impact of robotic regional anesthesia? As you can see here, this is a review article in the current opinion of anesthesiology, October 2014, 6 years back, about robotic or robot regional anesthesia. You can see this respectable doctor doing ultrasonography from a different room and the patient in another room using this probe. So it is possible to do ultrasonography now remotely. I'll take you a step forward. You have the robotic arm, you have the ultrasound picture, you have an artificial brain. I mean by artificial brain, artificial intelligence, which is going strongly to several aspects of our medical career. Artificial intelligence will contribute majorly in the future of radiology. You feed the computer or the artificial machine or artificial intelligence with thousands of pictures, and with artificial intelligence, the robot will diagnose, will localize the lesions without radiology. The same will be done with ultrasound. As you can see here, this article will appear March 2021 about the artificial intelligence for image interpretation in ultrasound guided regional block. In the near future, with the use of artificial intelligence, I can assure you, robot artificial intelligence will be able to interpret the image of ultrasound to localize the target nerve or target plexus and mechanically inject the local anesthetic. We finished the agenda and it's time now for a take-home message. COVID-19 is definitely a nightmare. We have been locked down for almost 1 year. We lost a lot of our beloved ones. However, according to Albert Einstein, in the midst of every crisis lies great opportunities. We have changed our practice and will change it more. We are more oriented now with appropriate infection control. We have innovations and more innovations will come. And hopefully we are more recognized by the community. With the development of several vaccines, we were pleased. We thought we will say soon goodbye to coronavirus. We'll be released from the frustrating lockdown. We accepted the new normal life even after the vaccine. However, the frustrating news came a few days ago. New variant of COVID-19 identified in England, and it has been identified in several other countries over the last few days. And I'm sure more unknown viruses are in the pipeline. Therefore, my sincere advice to all of you, consider all patients from now onwards as patients suspected with COVID-19. Every patient should be according, and I'm doing this in my practice now. We need to have a new normal practice. Telemedicine, whenever possible. Regional anesthesia should be your first choice. Very careful intubation using rapid sequence intubation video laryngoscopy, and very careful extubation after adequate recovery from anesthesia and from neuromuscular block. And at the end, I wish you Merry Christmas and thank you very much for your kind attention.
Prof. Abdulatif, thank you so much for this exciting lectures. I hope at the end of this year to finish this era of COVID for many reasons. First of all, I think first, this is the first lecture I have ever seen in the anesthesia and related to the COVID, as you said in the beginning of your lecture. I hope to finish COVID and Corona at the end of 2020 because of many reasons. The first one is to see our professors and our colleagues physically in the conferences and to enjoy with your lectures and discuss with you, Prof. Abdulatif. Second, because as you mentioned in the future, the robotic may replace the anesthetists, so we'll sit at home. And this will be very bad future for the anesthesiologists.
It will reduce
the chance for the anesthesiologist, of course. I have one question because we are applying in our institute, Prof. Is there any difference to anesthetize a confirmed COVID patient in what is called negative pressure room versus positive pressure room?
Actually, I asked, I don't know what's the setup in your location or Saad or other. I asked in my hospital about whether it is positive or negative. They said the OR is positive. The ICU is negative.
We have in OR some negative pressure rooms. And maybe they recommend to intubate the COVID positive person in this negative room, and after that to transfer to the positive room. And for myself, I don't know, but I am against this rule because transferring patient after intubating in negative and is more risky than to intubate the patient in the same room. What do you think?
I support you. If you believe that negative pressure room, and this is true, will be better regarding infection control, intubate and do assign one negative room to do COVID-19 patient. And this is appropriate. You cannot intubate only the patient in negative and transmit the infection to the other room. This is not logical. Do the procedure, intubation, the whole procedure in assign one or two rooms if you have a high flow to patient with COVID-19. And this, if it is possible, could be negative. Negative, not positive.
Thank you. Thank you.
Many thanks, Professor Dr. Abdulatif, for such illustrative, informative, amazing as usual. I can't talk always updated and incredible actually.
Totally.
It's another subject, another lecture. Incredible, I admit. We have some questions. Dr. Talat Al-Abd asked about vaccinated patients. We have Doherty in the era of the vaccination. He asked if the patient is vaccinated, if either by first shot or the second shot, many days before surgery, for elective surgery. Just patient to be postponed, and if I postpone, for how long? And I can admit a patient that has a first shot of the vaccine or a second shot, at any time after vaccination?
This information, the vaccine have just come in practice few days or weeks, and there is no literature to answer this question. I think regarding delay or not delay, it depends on, you are talking about a vaccinated patient, maybe he did not have COVID-19, isn't it?
No, he didn't have. He has it for protection. He has for prophylaxis. He had it. He asked if the patient will have some symptoms or some manifestations after the vaccination. For how long do we have to be safe not to anesthetize our subject?
This information is not yet available. Okay. I cannot speculate. But I can remind you, treat all patients as COVID-19 suspected, as I concluded in my take-home message. This is what I can tell you at this stage. But regarding the vaccination and the interval after vaccination, it is too early to have literature on this.
Dr. Hani Dhaif asked about the sterilization of a machine. If I anesthetize the patients without any precautions, I anesthetized the patients, and I discovered afterward that he has a COVID or is a COVID positive. How can I sterilize such anesthetic machine?
Again, this is not my specialty. This is a biomedical issue or CSSD issue. This is not my job.
I think according to the manual of the anesthetic machine or the company will answer such a question. There is also another question from Dr. Ramiz Ibrahim. What about closed loop opioids? I didn't get the question if it is supposed to for the post-operative pain management or what. I don't.
Post-operative, he means?
He said about what about closed loop opioids?
I said in my normally for balanced anesthesia, we give the example I have given is TIVA. And TIVA is commonly done with propofol and ribofentanil. If this is the opioid, he means it is the same.
He asked about the infusion robots. He said now if about the infusion but didn't mention opioids. I asked about that. Yeah, you can use it.
Maybe he's asking about PCI, Prof. Maybe he's asking about PCI.
PCI is not closed loop. This is very important. Very good, Assam. You told me there will be a confusion between TCI and the closed loop. TCI is not closed loop. You know, TCI is they have measured the pharmacokinetics. They have measured the concentration of anesthetic, intravenous anesthetic or opioid in the target organ. They made a mathematical model, and you put the age, the weight of the patient, and the parameters. Then the infusion will give, according to the previous experience of other patients, what is expected to be adequate for this patient. There is no closed loop. There is no bispectral index with TCI. Closed loop, you must measure the bispectral index, cardiac or whatever, and according to the depth of anesthesia, it will give the appropriate amount of infusion from the anesthetic and from the analgesic. Very good. This is very important, and this is a common confusion between TCI and closed loop.
Oh, Dr. Ramiz is insisting that he's closed about closed loop robotics. Robotics, I don't think PCE.
Pharmacological, we said we have two robotic system relation to anesthesia. Pharmacological robot and the mechanical robot.
Okay.
The pharmacological robot, we talked about closed loop anesthesia. And we give an example about hypnosis and analgesia combined together in two syringe pump managed by microprocessor and bispectral index. And we give the example of ventilation, and we have given the example of fluid therapy, and also neuromuscular transmission have been done since 1980. Closed loop control from the peripheral nerve stimulator to the infusion pump, but I didn't mention for the sake of time.
There is comments about the use of robotics. Dr. Ahmed Musad asked, what about the legal responsibility? They always need a victim to sue. For either robotics will be used, who will be asked? Ask it for that.
No, definitely it will be under supervision. You will not leave the robot. You will utilize the robot, but you will be responsible, of course.
Dr. Ayman asked about how to avoid rapid desaturation in COVID patients with rapid sequence induction, especially bagging or high flow oxygen during intubation, increase the aerosol generation. If we use a bag, I think it is not recommended to you bag patients before.
Yes, I said this was very clear from my lecture. I think it is recommended everybody with suspected and with proof COVID-19, you should do rapid sequence intubation, preferably with videolar endoscope. How to do it without minimizing the saturation? Appropriate pre-oxygenation. I said 5 minutes with two hands to minimize aerosolization with the lowest possible flow of oxygen, 2 or 3 liters to minimize aerosolization. Rapid sequence. It is rapid sequence. Yes. There is no bagging in rapid sequence. To make it more easier, you need to give good dose either of succinylcholine, which is not available in most of the situation now, or good dose of rocuronium, about 1 to 1.2 milligram per kilogram, in order to have 60 seconds. If you do pre-oxygenation appropriately, induce your patient, you can have 60 seconds safely, and with the use of video laryngoscope, if possible, I said you will have more success and more distancing. So the chance in a straightforward intubation for desaturation will be not that high.
Thank you, Dr.
Mohamed. If the patient desaturated, you will do bagging.
Yes. There is a last question from me, actually. Because the PCR is so expensive and it takes times a very long time to be results, can we do lab results for totally lab investigations for the patients, including the COVID labs, such as the CRP and ferritin, D-dimer, to exclude if the patient has COVID already or not, like CBC?
Actually, this is usually the first step. Everybody will do this blood laboratory work. But if it is very suggestive, what are you going to do? Ferritin is high, D-dimer is high. Normally, it is followed by PCR. But I can tell you, you start by this. If it is, I don't know the expenses of the ferritin.
Less expensive now. Yes. Now it is.
Will be less. By this, it is negative. No need to do PCR. But if it is very suggestive, you have to do PCR.
Okay. Many thanks, Dr. Mohamed. You always wonderful to have and listen to your speech. Always amazing. I thank you very much.